Hello everyone, I am Ashant Arun from Cisco Labs. Today we will be talking about asynchronous programming in Java. So let's jump into the video. This is our agenda today. First we will understand what is asynchronous programming. Then we will learn the completable feature, which helps us to write asynchronous code in Java. Then we will refresh our knowledge in multi-threading techniques in Java. Then we will see a real-life application that we can use asynchronous pattern and multi-threading together to write efficient code in Java. So let's start the tutorial. What is asynchronous programming? Asynchronous programming is a form of parallel programming that allows a unit of work to run separately from the primary application thread. So when you are doing asynchronous programming, you don't need to wait one task to finish to start the next one. So that is why we are calling it non-blocking. So once the first task is finished, you can continue working on it. So here we have a diagram that explains the synchronous pattern and asynchronous pattern. So we have the client and server here. In synchronous pattern, client make the request to the server and waiting for the response. Since this time it will not do any work. Once the response is received, it will continue working on it. So that is the synchronous pattern. In asynchronous pattern, client make the request to the server and it does not wait to receive the response. So in the meantime, it will continue working on some other task. Once the response is received, it will work on not work. It will start working on that response as well. So let's see how we can do asynchronous programming in Java. Completable feature is used for asynchronous programming in Java. Java 8 introduced this feature. Completable feature extends the future interface. This future interface allows us to attach callbacks to this completable future methods. So once the task is completed, this callbacks will be automatically triggered and the code inside that callbacks will be executed. And also this completable future allows us various standards, techniques and patterns that we can achieve the parallelism and write asynchronous code in Java. So let's talk about multi-threading in Java. Today I am not going to explain basics of the multi-threading, just need to refresh knowledge in multi-threading. So there are a few ways you can achieve multi-threading in Java. Extend thread class is the first one, the other one is implementing runnable and the callable interface. And also I want to highlight some important areas in multi-threading, that is the execute service. So if we are doing multi-threading in Java, we need to create threads manually and manage them manually. So this may lead to resource wastage and inefficient code. So if we are using executor service, so it will offer us a thread pools and we can submit task runnable task into that executor service. So it will manage the threads and run those tasks efficiently for us. So this using the executor service, we can do efficient multi-threading. And also I want to highlight the scheduler. So scheduler helps us to execute a task periodically. If we are doing it manually, we need to write a while loop and use a sleep statement to achieve that. So scheduler also helps us to do that task periodically in an efficient manner. So let's deep dive into the completable future and understand the methods and patterns in the completable future. So there are a few methods like run async and supply async. You can achieve the parallelism, and there are few ways you can attach callbacks, and there are some other scenarios you want to combine futures. That means if there are multiple tasks running parallelly and you want to combine their results once they completed, you can use this combined future methods as well. So let's take each of them and see how they are behaving. So if you want to run a task asynchronously in background and do not want to return anything, you can use this run async method. So let's see the code example and how it behaves. So I have some codes written here. I will explain the code and we'll see how it will work. So I'm using this run async method. You can pass a runnable task into this run async method. And inside this run method, you can include your code. So let's run this and see how this will behave, and I'll explain the code. So as you can see, the main method is starting to execute this method. So that is why you can see method invoked at this time by the main thread. And you can see at the same time, separate thread will start working on this parallel task. That is why you can see async task started at the same time with the separate thread. It's not the main thread. And also the important thing you can see here is the main thread is not hanging here to complete this task. So it comes down here and it can execute some other task. That is why we can see doing some other work by main thread. So after this task is finished, you can use this get method, then you can get the you can get the results. So that is the run async method. So let's move into the second method. So we have the supply async method. So if you want to run a task background and you want to return something, you can use this supply async method. So let's see how it will work. So as earlier, the main thread is starting to execute this method. That is why you can see the method invoked at this given time by the main thread. At the same time, you can see another separate thread will start executing this the parallel task. And you can see main thread is not hanging there. It will come down here and start working on some other work as well. So this method, we are returning a string. So after, it will take 5 seconds to produce that string. So you can see async task finished at this given time. So you can see the time difference here. It's the 5 seconds difference because I'm putting that thread to a five second sleep. So after the completion of this task, you can get the result using this future.get method. So let's talk about callbacks. Callbacks are important when we are doing asynchronous programming. So completable future allows us to attach callbacks. So the task is completed. When the task is completed, the callback will be automatically triggered and it will execute the code inside that function. So there are a few ways you can achieve that. There are then accept, then run and then apply methods. So in then accept and then run method will not return anything. So if you want to run a piece of code and do not want to return anything after the task is completed, you can use these first two methods. Then apply method is bit different. You can use then apply method to transform a result of a completable future result. So we'll see how it will work. So the then apply method is used to process and transform the result of a completable future method. And it is possible to write a sequence of transformation using series of then apply callbacks. So we'll see how it will behave in the code. So in here, I will explain the code and we'll see how it is behaving. First, I'm starting with starting this parallel task using the supply async method. Inside that, I'm just putting this thread to sleep for 3 seconds, and I will produce a string and return that string after the completion of this task. So then that string will be passed into this second task using the then apply method. So after the completion of the first task, the result will be passed in the second task using this then apply method. So then this second task will take 5 seconds and it will process the input and it will produce a different string. So after the completion of this second task, it will pass that result into this third task. So using then apply method. So it also takes some different time. And it will produce another different string from the first one. And finally, it will return the final result. So we'll run this method and see how it will work. So as you can see, the main method is starting to invoke this function. So that is why we can see method invoked at this given time by the main task. And also in the same time, you can see this this first parallel task is started by this by another thread at the same time. So and you can see the important thing here, main thread is not waiting to waiting for any of this task completed. So it will come down here and it can work on some other task as well. So that is the important thing to highlight here. And you can see at the same time main thread is doing some other work. And you can see the second task is started after 3 seconds. That's because I'm putting this thread to 3 seconds, putting sleep to this thread to 3 seconds. So after 3 seconds, you can see the second task is started to work. And I am putting 5 seconds sleep to this second task thread. So that is why you can see there is a 5 seconds different in between these two tasks. So and you can see the third task taking 2 seconds to produce this string, and it is so that is why you can see there are 2 seconds gap in this third task starting time and finishing time. So and finally you can use this get method and get the final result. So the first task will return this Ashan string, and it will the second one will concat this Tarindu to this the first string, and finally this third task will attach hello to this string, and you can see the final result we can see here. So now we have combined futures. So if there are parallel task parallel multiple task running parallelly, and you want to combine the results, you can use this combined futures method. So if you want to combine two methods, you can two tasks, you can use this then combine method. And there if there are multiple tasks and you want to get the result once all of them finished, or if there are multiple tasks and you want to get the result once one task is finished, so you can use these methods. So we'll see the code examples and see how will they work. So I'll explain the code first. Here we have the first parallel task. I'll named it as a first future. So this first task will produce a string, and we have the second task as well. So this task will take 5 seconds to produce that string, and the second task will take 2 seconds to produce that string. So then I'm combining those two. My goal here is to get the result after completion of both parallel tasks. So in here, using this then combine method, I am combining the first future with the second future and their results. In this way, we can combine the first future and the second future. Then we can get the final result of it. So we'll run the code and see how it is behaving. So the main method is starting to execute this method. So that is why we can see method invoked at this time by the main thread. And you can see in the same time, both first task and second task started to work. And you can see the main method is not hanging there. So it will start come down here and it will start working on some other work. So that is why you can see at the same time it is working on some other works as well. And you can see after 2 seconds, the second task finished, and after 5 seconds, first task is finished. So the and finally I can get the result of the final process, and you can see the first task taking the longer time to finish, and that is why we have all the tasks are finished at the time that the first task finished its work. So now let's see all of examples as well. So you can use this method to combine multiple parallel tasks. Here I have the first task, this task will take 5 seconds to produce this result one string, and we have the second task. It will take 3 seconds to produce the task, produce the results, and this third task will take 2 seconds to produce that results. So in here, I'm combining all those futures using this OLOF method. So I'm wrapping this all the completable future into one completable future method. So that completable future is not returning anything, but to get results, I'm streaming through those futures array, and I will join using this join method. I will get the results of those completable future array, and finally you can get the results using this completable future get method. So let's run this code and I'll explain the behavior as well. So you can see main method starting to work, start to execute this method in this time, and you can see at the same time all three tasks are started to work with three using three separate threads. You can see the thread names, they are different. And also the important thing to highlight here is the main thread is not hanging to for waiting for any of these tasks to complete. So it will go down and start working on some other works. And you can see as per the given times, those tasks are finished. And you can see first task is taking the highest time to finish the task. And you can see that is why the all tasks are finished at this same time as the first task. So that is the basics of a completable future. So now let's move into the real life application that we can use this asynchronous pattern and multithreading together to write efficient code. So I will explain this application. So in here we have a produce application, and we have this consume application, and we have this queue. The produce application will produce messages and push those messages into this queue, and this consumer application does not have any idea when this application put message into this queue or how many messages it will push to this queue. So our task is, our goal is in this application is to consume the messages in this queue and process them in an efficient way. So in this our consumer application, there are two main components. The one is this queue polling task. The other one is consuming task and processing unit. So I'm going to explain what is happening if we use a synchronous pattern to achieve this thing. So once this task is polling the queue, it's a synchronous process. That means when you call the queue, it will take some time to receive the message. So till that messages are receiving, all other processes are blocked. So this this component can't process any messages because we are waiting these messages to receive. And when executor service executing, when if we processing these messages in here, so that will block the polling process as well. So polling needs to wait till this processing is finished. So that is why I'm using asynchronous pattern and multithreading to do this in efficient manner. So I will explain my approach. I'm using a separate thread and scheduler to poll the queue periodically. So this task will periodically poll the queue using a separate thread. So it's not blocking anything. And I'm using completable future and attaching a callback to this polling task. So once the messages are received, it will trigger the processing functions. In the meantime, in this processing component, I'm using runnable task and execute service. So it will use a pool of threads to execute those tasks parallelly. So this from the processing, the polling is not blocked by the processing because we are using separate set of threads using executor service. So let's jump into the code and see how this will work. So before going to that, I will need to refresh your knowledges in multi-threading techniques in Java. So in here we have my runnable and callable. The difference with runnable and callable is if you want to run a task parallelly and you want to return something, you can use callable, otherwise you can use runnable. So I have two examples here. I will run them and explain the code as well. So in my in this runnable section, what I'm doing here is I'm assigning a number to this task, and it will print out the all the numbers between 0 and that number. So I'm creating three tasks here, and I'm using the execute service, and I'm assigning those tasks into this execute service. So we'll see how this will work. So you can see I'm assigning those tasks into execute service. So all the tasks are starting at the same time by separate threads. And you can see it's executing randomly. So the I've assigned 8, 5 and 3 to those tasks. So it will printing out those tasks random, those tasks parallel. And we'll see the callable example as well. In here also I am assigning a number to this task, and when and it will get the summation of the numbers in between 0 and that number. So inside this call method I have included my code logic, and we will run this and see how this will work. So you can see I'm creating three callable tasks using three different sizes. So and I'm attaching creating array using those callable tasks, and I'm invoke all of them using the execute service. So you can see all three tasks are started at the same time by separate threads, and you can see those three tasks are taken different times to finish the task. And that is why you can see the first task is taken 3 seconds, the second one 5, third one 8. So after the completion of all the tasks, we can take the results in here as well. So now let's move into our queue consume application and see how it will work. So in here, I have the task. So when I'm receiving a message from the queue, I will assign that message into this task. And I don't want to return anything, just want to simulate the processing that message and saving that message into the database. I'm getting the message content and I'm attaching this string to identify that I process that message, and I am putting the thread to random number sleep so we can understand behavior of this one. And we have the queue listener here, so there are some section I want to explain to you. First we have this poll queue method. So actually I am not doing this things actually, I'm just mocking these operations to understand this application behavior. So this poll queue method will poll the queue, and it will give us a random number of messages after 2 seconds. And we have this consume message function. So I'm using asynchronous function here. Asynchronous function to attach callback. So this poll queue, this completable future method execute poll queue. So that is a asynchronous method. and we don't need to wait for that messages to receive. And after the messages are received, this then the function inside this then apply async method will be executed. So in here we have the process messages. So once the messages are received from the queue, we can this process message is automatically triggered. So in here I am taking the message and I am creating a task using the task processor that I explained earlier, and I am submitting those tasks into the execute service. So it will manage the processing parallelly for us. Then finally we have this schedule polling method. So this schedule polling method will execute periodically this consume messages task. In here we are polling the queue periodically, and once the message are received, we are redirecting those messages into the execute service. So that's the example. We'll see how this example will behave. So in here I'm creating a queue listen object, and I'm starting the schedule polling method. So it will start the polling the queue. So you can see here, I'll explain the results of this application. So the polling queue at this given time by this thread. You can see number of messages are received one. So that is why it's creating this task and submitting to the execute service. So you can see started processing task zero. So that is the first task we received, and it will be processed by this separate thread. And you can see as I coded here, the task processor will take random time to complete that task. We don't have idea about that. So the task zero is completed by this thread, that is the thread, and we can get the result. I have logged the results into the terminal. So you can see that content is processed by checking this string, and you can see this is going on and on and on. So it is not blocking anything, nothing is waiting for any other process to work. This polling queue will be using a separate thread to poll the queue processing is not blocked by that. And once the messages are received, it will redirect those messages into the executor service. And you can see here we have three number of messages received, and you can see those three are started to process by three different threads. So this is one application use case that you can use asynchronous pattern and multi-threading together to write efficient code. Hope you all enjoyed the video. Thank you.